And to all you people back in the Shire, turn your porch lights off because we're coming home with a trophy.
Hey there, welcome to Sharkcast Pod, a podcast dedicated to the greatest sporting club in the history of the world, the mighty Cronulla Sutherland Sharks. This show is brought to you by Dyson Logistics, the Royal Motor Yacht Club in Port Hacking, and Jason Hawes from Cripps and Cripps Real Estate. My name is Sam Shinazzi, I'm an OG from 2015, 10th season of podcasting, having a ball doing so. Thank you to everyone who's helped with the show throughout the years, and thank you to everyone who's been listening, whether you're an OG yourself, or whether you're a newcomer, or in between. Completely appreciate your support. Thank you for writing in. Thank you for buying the merch at rugbyleaguemerch.com. Thank you for everything. Mailbag heavy episode today because it's a short week. We've got the Tigers on a Friday night. I'm recording this on Monday night. So today, this morning, we did catching up with Kieran over coffee about Cronulla. Go consume that if you haven't. Many of you have. Completely appreciate that. It's also on the YouTube, an unedited version of that. This is going to be mailbag because of the week that is coming up. Short week for the club, for the podcast, for me. And it's pretty much my only time I'm going to get to record before a reasonable amount of time that you can sink your teeth into this episode and enjoy the game as well. So a lot of you have written in. I wanted to respect that and get an episode out featuring your mail. No co-host tonight just because of the way things are. Hope that's cool with you all. We will have people lined up for future episodes really, really shortly. But yes, if you haven't heard the episode released earlier today with Kieran Fraser, it's a great chat between two friends talking about the mighty Cronulla Sutherland Sharks, as well as UFOs and other things, but mainly the Cronulla Sutherland Sharks. So, today, Monday, at training, there was a mishap. There was a incident. There was an event, which many of you have heard about by now. Unfortunately, Nicho Hynes was injured. It was one of the last plays of the training session and fairly innocent enough kind of activity, and his ankle is now severely injured. At the time of recording this, we don't have anything official as far as how long he's out for and scans, but my only thing that I can say to people who are listening to this before the big news comes in is that I think that it's probably potentially going to be worse than better. Hopefully it's some miracle, and it's not. As someone who was there, it was not a good scene. Players were doing their best to do their extras after the incident, and I keep saying incident, I don't know if that's too dramatic. He got injured. That's the better thing to say. It wasn't an incident. He got injured, and we're all sad now. So hopefully Nicho can come back sooner rather than later, sending him our best. It's going to be a challenging time for the Sharks, no doubt about that. Without him, it gets a lot harder, in my opinion. The one thing I will say is that I get the feeling this team's going to fight and scrap for everything from here on in until he comes back. Minutes after it happened and the session was over and the players were doing their extras, Captain Cam McInnes, he called over Blake Brayley, Dan Atkinson, Braden Trindle and Will Kennedy, the spine, and had a great chat with them for about 5 to 10 minutes, private chat in the middle of the field, and that was reassuring. They're addressing things. I briefly spoke to the coach. He was concerned, but getting on with his business and working out what the plan was going to be. By the time some of you hear this, there will be a team named. You're not going to hear a podcast about that, but right now I can tell you that Nicho Hynes, I feel like he's going to be out for a while. So, that's that. And when we have more news and we have time to podcast, we'll definitely address it. All right, in no particular order, to be fair. Here's some mail. Hope you enjoy. This is from Tony. Tony is an excellent human being and a very passionate Sharkcast listener. He said, just got back from coughs. And apart from the putrid result, we had a fantastic trip away with close friends. Had the pleasure of bumping into fellow Sharkcaster Dr. Cameron Webb. It was great to say g'day and have a chat about the game. Awesome dude. Also attached a photo, which is great. Thank you very much. As I type, the news about Nicho has hit. I know you'll disagree, Sam, but to be brutally honest, the time off will be a blessing in disguise. Fingers crossed it's not for too long. As for the game itself, I can't elaborate on what's already been said about the slow starts, clunky attack, and appalling discipline. They all know what the problems are. The issue is they're not rectifying it. Essentially, it's been the same squad all year, just the results are now different. It's frustrating. Thankfully, our great start to the season is paying off, which means we aren't dropping down the ladder anywhere near as quickly as we probably should. I'm quietly confident we'll sort this mess out eventually. Sneaking a win this Friday night won't fix everything, but it will make us all feel a bit better. There's a long way to go just yet. Always remember, form is temporary, class is permanent. Up, up from Tony. Thank you so much, Tony. Glad you got to meet Cam. Cam is one of the great human beings in the world. One of the smartest, one of the just most loveliest people you'll ever meet. He's a very good friend of mine. We've been friends for probably 25 to 30 years, and he's done a lot for me in my life, and I really love Cam so much. I'm glad he's involved in the show. Glad you got to hang out with him. As for your points, Tony, do I think it's a good time for Nicho? I don't know if I'm going to fall into that line of thinking. You're right. I understand what you're saying. Mentally, he will be away from the pressure of week-to-week footy. I guess my whole thing is that I was hoping he would come out the other end sooner rather than later. Thanks so much for being in touch, Tony. Love to Mel. Stephen says, after listening to your Titans recap pod with Dan Nichols, Nicho is being labelled mentally weak because he's been outspoken in the mental health space, spoken about past struggles, and been an advocate. Hynes is out of form in football. That's it. It's insulting and damaging for the media and fans to say he's mentally weak due to football-related struggles. Doesn't absolve him of criticism on the football field at all, but let's be critical of specific parts of his game and not just slap he's mentally not good on it. He's truly the best ambassador for our club, seems to be a genuinely good person, talented, hard-working player, and I'm confident the football struggles will turn themselves around in time. Nicho forever, negative non-construction criticism never. Rant over. That's from Steve. That's well said, man, and said it better than I could. And I addressed that on the recap show with Dan Nichols, and he was talking about how people were saying that he's not mentally okay to play football and that kind of thing, to generalize. And I pointed out what you just pointed out. I said, well, there's never been an issue where he said he's not mentally okay to play. I should point out some of this mail is going to be dated because of what's happened to Nicho, and if we come across that, we'll address it. But excellent work, Stephen. Thanks so much for being in touch. David says, the Sharks' recent failure to win close games is obviously disappointing. What I find equally disappointing is some of the commentary that's associated with the current predicament. We all want victory. It lifts our moods. Life becomes better, and we can swagger a confident stride for the following week. What I find ridiculous is the unrealistic expectation that players will perform above average each week. Comments such as, he's earning X amount, he should do better, and he's not trying. Sure, the expectation is there. However, every week in park football, guys try their hardest for the love of the game and $0. The comment I loathe the most fiercely, the fans deserve better. Seriously, how arrogant. If a player is thinking about a fan, that is a concern. I know without fans there isn't a team, but to believe that a player or a team is basing their performance on a fan's feelings, I'm now concerned for that fan. Every game there's only one winner. Each season there's one premiership to win. Sure, get angry, be disappointed, but blaming a different player every week. Well, to the people that say drop Nicho, once I stop scoffing and laughing in your general direction, I have this to say. Mitch Moses, New South Wales halfback, his team is equal last. DCE, Queensland halfback, showing good form in two wins less than the Sharks. For the record, DCE has not won a premiership since 2011. Both are good players that have had time to develop. Paul Gallen, the oldest player to ever play NRL, has only won one premiership. He didn't quit, and I think the fans should be as dedicated and impatient. ET, Sharks legend, never won a premiership. We need patience, add some experience, manage expectation, and our luck is due to change. The last 3 weeks have been below expectation. However, not one of those losses have the Sharks conceded more tries. They say they are not far off. Up, up. So that's from David. some wise words there. The opening few bits of mail are actually ones that I've endorsed by accident. I agree with everything they're saying, and the only reason I'm reading them out is they're probably the most recent ones that I've seen. But David, I agree with you there, and it's tough doing the whole the fans thing deserve better, because in one sense they do. The fans, I'm a fan. I deserve a successful team. How arrogant is that? But I completely see what you're saying, and I completely agree with you. It's not about... Well, I completely agree with you that there's an unrealistic expectation on performances sometimes. It doesn't mean teams can go out and play terrible every week for 80 minutes, but this team's not doing that. There's room for improvement, and we know we can get there. Phil says, "Hey, Sam and podcast team, apart from the obvious frustrating heartbreak of losing to the lower ladder Titans, a couple of points I'd like to mention. I saw David Fifita get put on his back maybe once, always standing in tackles. Iro and Ramian are not getting enough early ball. Can Trindle only do end-over-end kicks? I'm a big Nicho fan, but the way he just flopped over the try line when he scored, he always looks in two minds. We should be sitting on 30-plus in the ladder, hoping our season can get back on track, especially for the run home into the finals. Love your show. I do try to stay positive. Up the Sharks." That's from Phil the Fiery in Willow Vale, Queensland. So, on all that, Phil, I thought they handled Fifita pretty well, particularly because Nicho was doing a lot of the tackling. I thought it was okay. He didn't really dominate us, I don't think. I agree with you that Iro and Remy need more early ball. I'm with you. I hope our season starts to improve. Thanks for being in touch. Hope you're well. Shane says, "I want to appeal to Sharks fans to give Nicho some love. He was highly regarded at Melbourne. They wanted to keep him, and he had other offers, but he chose the mighty Sharkies. He loves the Sharks. I'd love to see people holding up banners in support of Nicho this Friday night. Let's get through the tough times with him, not against him, because after all, we are all in this together." I did notice Canterbury's hero Matt Burton missed another 3 field goals to go with his 2 from the week before. DCE missed a dolly, not to mention Chad chipping in 3 stray ones as well. It happens. Stay strong, Nicho. You also say the show is still killing it. You make the drive to work a lot easier. Well done. Keep up the good work. Thank you, Shane. I completely appreciate you saying that and your support and listening. Thank you so much. I say it a lot. I mean it every single time. Thank you so much. Look, Nicho is not going to be there this Friday in a playing capacity. You know, I think if people wanted to make some banners for Nicho, it would surely brighten his day. I think it's probably a tad excessive, but I'm certainly not against the idea. Thanks for being in touch, Shane. Paul says, "I have a theory. Fitzy was an understudy to Robbo at the Roosters. Robbo manages the team through the year, so they explode at finals time. Obviously, they want to win, but you can't be up every game. Roosters are the same. They don't want to win the minor premiership, but mostly are always around the top four. Last couple of years, we've lost in the finals. Therefore, this is a different strategy this year. I think Fitzy's playing the long game, preparing for the finals. Now that we're in the finals, I think Fitzy's flogging the team at training, and thus we're a bit off and slower on the weekend. Look at the last 5 games in 2016. We lost most of them because of the extra work they were doing at training, readying themselves for the finals." That's from Paul. I hope that some of that is true. I don't know if it actually is, but I understand what you're saying. And let's see what happens this Friday night. I think that you're saying we're already in the finals. I mean, we're pretty close if we're not there already, but you know there's a lot of movement in the next 9 or 10 weeks. So we need to win some games to stay where we are at the very least. Thank you for being in touch, Paul. We had a YouTube comment on our post-game show with Dan. And it's from David, and it said, "Sack the coach today, not tomorrow." One of the OGs, Jason, has written in, said, "Hope you're well. Great to see you on YouTube. Have a question for you and your listeners. What is the one thing you need to be successful at achieving or doing whatever you want in life?" You know I've asked that question before, and I say the answer all the time. I'll give you my answer next email, and I'll give you a clue. Bellyache knows it. Okay, so Jason says, what's the one thing you need to be successful at achieving or doing whatever you want in life? He's going to keep us hanging. He's going to get back to us. He says, stay safe and well. Hi to Adam. Best wishes and up, up. I will pass on your regards to Adam. Adam is Adam Newman, one of the two OGs, and I will pass on your hello. Corey says, another terrible week for the Sharks. I heard your last podcast, Sam, where you said you don't like Origin. Well, I totally agree with you. They should be playing it at the end of the year. You believe that's what started our slump. You said previously where the problem lies, but it needs urgent attention. Nico's form slump is something only he can work on. You thought he should take a couple of weeks off and play Tricky and Echo in the halves. Well, that's going to happen, my friend, due to unfortunate circumstances, which you're well aware of. You also think Tommy and Brayley and Kennedy need a week or two off. The slump will end versus the Tigers. If not, I fear for our season. We need changes. Hopefully they can fix this up and be ready for the Tigers. At least show us they really want this and they are back. Thanks, and as always, up, up. Thanks, Corey. Stay strong. Appreciate your thoughts. Yeah, not a fan of Origin myself, just because of what it does. Have it at the end of the year. I probably don't want it preseason. I know that makes no sense anyway, but I think just have it at the end of the year. Blaze says, long-time listener, long-time Shark supporter, first time on here. Okay, thank you, Blaze, for being in touch. I don't do social media, so I don't see all the idiots carrying on about players or the Sharks. But I do get affected by all these winnable losses. I'm not here to bag out players because we all see who deserves to be there and who doesn't. I'm here, however, because I want somebody to get me answers. I know some of you are fairly close to the players or you can get the info. I can't. But players are always interviewed, but why never Nicho? I need to hear it from his own mouth. A Sharks one-on-one interview on his true feelings of what's happening. My father, who is now in his 80s, used to be a coach back in his day for 15 years. He's seen a lot and he knows a lot about teams' performances. He was telling me he coached teams similar to the Sharks' performance of how they are now, top of the ladder, then lost games later in the season. He said those teams never recovered. He doesn't think the Sharks will recover either. My father was always a Newtown Jets supporter of old, but now he supports the Sharks since they are with the Jets. He actually started supporting the Sharks, who were always his second team since the Jets' extinction. But I've always supported the black, white, and blue. It seems the coach doesn't want to make big decisions. By now, he should know who deserves to be there and who doesn't. I like Big Tapua, Colquhoun, and Sam Stonestreet. These guys should be in the starting 17. Someone needs to be held accountable, whether it's the coach or certain players, but unless these changes are made, it all comes back to the coach. I suggest don't watch Friday night unless you like being disappointed. The Tigers will be the next team to beat them unless changes are made. You also say that the coach should bring back ex-players like Gal and Louis to toughen up the team and show what it means to play for the club. You are behind the team. You say, let's get it done, but you're also calling yourself an upset Sharks fan. So, Blaze, thanks for being in touch for starters. Really appreciate it. Appreciate you being a long-time listener. And don't be a stranger. It's awesome that you've been in touch. I feel your pain. I know you're upset about the losses. Say hello to your dad for us. Sounds like a legend. I think that you will find there are changes in the works should things keep going the way they have. And don't forget that there have been some changes made this year already. So it's not like the coach is running at the same team every week, and in particular in reference to last year to this year. There have been changes. There's a bunch of guys who have injury clouds around them, and I think you will see some, for want of a better word, reserve graders come in to contention sooner rather than later. Thank you so much for being in touch. Neil says, it's been a tough couple of months. Hope you're holding up okay. Can't be easy with so much negativity of late. I'm doing okay, man. I mean, it's just footy, and we take it extremely seriously around here, as do our listeners, but I'm doing fine as far as the footy goes. If footy was my biggest concern in life, it would be a pretty casual, cruisy life to live, and I hope that's how it is for the majority of our people listening, if not all, but I'm doing fine as far as the footy goes. Thank you for being in touch, and you know, I'm in it for the long haul, as I've proven, and I'm in it in good times and bad. And right now, it's an in-between time. It's not bad times. We've been through so much worse. It's just we're not winning, and we need to win. You say, unfortunately, you're going to continue with some more negativity, so hang in there with a smiley face. We've been worked out by our opposition. It's easy to beat a dumb team that keeps beating itself. Yeah, that's fair enough. Completely agree with that. You're not into the crash plays by Blake Braley, which have crept back into the team's performance. And you also think that attacking weapons like Ronaldo are catching colds out in the wing. Hunter's proven to be effective off the bench as impact lately, so we start him. Why? A move that failed. I am with you on that one, although don't forget we defended for like 15, 20 minutes. So the big man didn't get too many runs in. But I'm not with Royce being a starter unless it's absolutely necessary at this point. We are the same team that won 7 in a row earlier this year, but we aren't playing the same. Nico's drop in form has been alarming. I feel for Nico. It's like he's having an identity crisis. He's definitely trying his guts out. The fix seems simple. Don't make errors. Show some discipline. Other teams are going to take our top four position. It's disgusting. Maybe they need to be set free, Sam. Just start playing footy and have some fun. Whatever they're doing now is not working. Thanks for everything you do. I need to get that off my chest. Anytime, Neil. Anytime you need to get your venting done, we are the place to do it because you do it fair and above the belt, and I appreciate that. I don't mind the idea of playing a bit more freestyle footy. I just don't think you can go nuts with it. But I don't mind the idea. I know what you're saying. We mentioned it today on the show with Kieran about just sort of starting a little bit more, less structured, less uptight with the football. But there is a danger to that as well, of course. Thanks, Neil. Matt says, the boys must be big Tom Petty fans. Just over a month ago, it was I won't back down, but now we're free falling. Hopeful of a turnaround. Love the pods each week. Cheers, Matt. Matt, that could be the email of the week, my friend. At the moment, you don't win anything but my praise. Thank you for being in touch. Jacqueline has been in touch as well. Jacqueline says, this team is flat and have run out of ideas. When you try three attempts at barge over tries, you've really got nothing in attack happening for you. Those attacking sets in the last 10 minutes were horrendous. They looked lost. Even worse was the end of the last set to possibly win the game. I'll refrain and not bash Nicho any more than what he's already copping. They've simply forgotten how to score tries and how to win. You then mentioned the poor starts. The first 8 minutes, maybe longer with zero possession. Get dominated and can't wrestle back possession and momentum. You then ask, what's my take on Nicho and Trindle walking off at halftime? I replayed it a couple of times. I'm not sure how to take it. They're clearly frustrated. On that, I don't know. I didn't see that. I need to go watch that again. Or I'm not sure what happened. I'm sensing there was some sort of negative bad feelings between the two of them. I'm not sure. So I can't comment on that right now. You're asking what our repeat set stats are. It feels like we never force anything. Thanks for the great work with the pod. One frustrated Sharks fan, Jacqueline. Thank you for listening. Thank you for writing in. I really appreciate it. I don't have the stats in front of me, but I can tell you that we are not into repeat sets very much. We talked about it a little bit on the show this morning, but there's a feeling that the Sharks at their best is when the ball is in play. So they like to keep the ball alive in attack, and they like to keep the defensive team just playing from kicks. So the kicks that sort of land in their opposition 20, they like to keep them down there in theory and keep the ball in play. And I think that's why they don't like the repeat sets necessarily. Whether that's going to stay that way for the rest of the year, I'm not sure, but I know that there was a strong theory and feeling that with the ball in play, on both sides of the ball, that was when we were at our best. We were quite fit this year, a lot fitter than seasons gone by. It was very noticeable. And, I mean, even in these last losses, we've come home really strong. So fitness doesn't seem to be a problem necessarily. Steve says, I don't live in Cronulla. I've been a few times, but gee, the beach must be good because these blokes haven't left it for the last few weeks. They're just not there for the opening 20 minutes. I've supported Cronulla for 30-odd years, and for quite a few of those, we've been not very good. I've just changed your words there a little bit. Unable to compete, and that's frustrating. But to have a side like we do now, they've shown they can beat the top sides, then drop their bundle like this is beyond frustrating. It's driving me bleeping wild. I stand by my comments in the previous email that we'll miss the eight. I've watched us for too long. I think Clinton Maynard said in response that we need 34 points for 4 wins to not miss the eight. Where do you see those wins coming? We've now lost to the bottom 3 sides in the comp. I thought Hynes looked better against the Titans, injecting himself into the game and seemed to really want it. I've been critical of him of late, but when you think about it, the good halfbacks of the comp have all had bad runs. I'll try to be more positive in my next email if the club that I have tattooed on my arm can hold the ball and stop giving away penalties. That's from Tomo. Man, that's a good way to finish. I like that. The old ink. Now, as I'm recording this, there is news coming through from different sources that the injury to Nicho could be 9 to 10 week recovery. So around finals time, whether that means he's going to be ready for finals, I can't tell you. But it's looking like it's going to be a long-term injury in that sense. I mean, I don't think it's going to be debilitating for a long time. I'm sure next year he'll be fresh, ready to go. But this year, I just think he's going to be missing a large chunk of footy from what we're hearing. We'll keep you updated on that as we go along. Blake says we need a change from this team. Siffer and Kennedy are the only two players who look like they wanted to play on the weekend. The thing is, if we've got 4+ Origin players playing, you can justify a mid-year slump. But sadly, everyone has figured us out. We're completely unencumbered by Origin and we're on a 3-game losing streak. Fitz has lost the team and he's probably lost me. I think he and Nicho are both badly overrated. That's from Blake. On that, Blake, I agree with some of what you're saying. People are talking about us and Origin and slumps, and it's really got nothing to do with it. Aside from if you want to say Nico's feelings were hurt by being dropped from the team, there is no other reason about that. So I agree with you. We're not in a slump because of Origin necessarily. I'm with you on that. Fitz has not lost the team. I can tell you that personally, he's not lost the team. If he's lost you, it's a different story. And we'll see what happens in the future there. And thank you so much for being in touch as always. Peter says, "Dear Sam, that was shite. Love, Pete." Nice and concise. Thank you, Pete. Greg says, "Fresh off another loss, I'm not filthy like I was last week, but I'm closer to broken after watching that. Unlike some fans we have, I'm not going to be dirty about it all week. I give myself 1 hour of being unhappy and then on to the next. But I'm a man of stats. They've now lost the last 9 first halves in a row. They're 1-4 since Trindle's return. I'm not saying he's the issue, but we were flying high with that co at 6. 1 try for Ronaldo in the last 5 since Trindle has come back. It seems Ronnie isn't getting the bombs close to the line on his side to be effective in attack. Our attack has really relied on through the middle and the right side, which is unfortunate. You might think I'm having digs at Tricky, but he was honestly one of our best tonight last week against the Titans. Once again, going down 12-0 early hurts, but credit to the team, they still get within reach. Hopefully it all gets turned around next week into Tigers. What do they need to do to fix this horrible run they're in? Is it fixable, or have they been figured out by other clubs? Do we need a hype man like Critter to bring the enjoyment into game day and training sessions? Cheers for the great pods every week. Love your work. Here's to hoping for a change of fortunes. The biggest Sharks fan of the Central West, Greg from Mudgee. Greg, thank you so much for your kind words. Thanks for being in touch. Great correspondence. Now, I like what you say. You allow yourself a little bit of downtime, like an hour, to be upset and you move on. That's a healthy way to be. I like it. Now, on to a few things you've said. How do they fix it? They fix it by starting well. Teams have not figured us out. We're hurting ourselves. Teams are not hurting us. We're hurting ourselves. I cannot say that clearly enough or often enough. Teams have not worked out us. We are killing ourselves, to be dramatic. our game day and our training sessions are pretty upbeat, and I've been blessed to be at probably more this year than I have in a long time. And they're a confident bunch of footballers who enjoy their each other's company. They have fun at work. They work really hard, and I don't believe that's a problem. James says, we've lost to the bottom three sides in the comp, which is very worrisome. Something is obviously very wrong, but what's important is not to lay blame on Nicho. He's not playing well, but also isn't the one dropping the ball and giving away multiple penalties. You do point out a few similarities between the last few years of doing well, getting to Origin, slumps, out in straight sets. You say next year only signing is AFB. Big acquisition, but I'm not sure it's the sole answer to get rid of all our problems. Jimmy from Ireland. I'll tell you what it does bring in, Jimmy. It brings in fear factor in the pack. It brings in intimidation. It brings in offloads. It brings in a very big minute player. And it means that there's competition for spots. And he's going to, I think, bring another level to training and how to play football on a week-to-week basis. Chris says, new listener to the show, but lifelong 36-year Sharks fan. Similar to Clinton, quite the pessimist and known to vent frustration like many passionate sports fans do. Firstly, huge fan of what you do. Taking the time for the Sharks fans, I love hearing the emotion in your voice. One question I do have. I don't know how big of a link you have to the club or whether you know the players personally, but do you ever hold back on thoughts or opinions because of a relationship you may or may not have with the club or a player? Being in a media setting, it would be difficult to find the balance between bashing a player, praising them, and being downright honest, especially regarding negativity or criticism. You also mentioned that you're disappointed in the last 5 weeks. Apologies for the long email. We're all good. No need for apologies. Love your work. Great to listen on the way down to work. That's from Chris, born in the Shire, living in Melbourne. Chris, thanks for being in touch. Glad you found us. Don't be a stranger. Tell all your friends and family about Sharkcast. So do I ever hold back on thoughts and opinions? I honestly don't. That being said, from day one, the pact on this show was to keep it family friendly, so PG, and also it was to never be personal about things. And when I say that, there's never going to be agendas, there's never going to be anything below the belt, there's never going to be anything unwarranted. So if you play really well, we'll talk about it. If you play really bad, we'll talk about it. You know, Toby had a bad game the other week. I talked about it. Today I saw him at training. I shook his hand, said, how you doing? Well done on the Jets game. Hope to see you back. I mean, everything's above board. I have a link with the club. I always have. I hope I always will. Really good group of guys this year, and the coach is really cool about his openness to letting me be around, and he gave me some time as well. And I said to him what I say to everyone, you know, we criticize the player if it's warranted, and we are constructive in that criticism, and we just tend not to these days, and I've been guilty of it in the past, but tend not to go off early about anything. You know, I could sit here and tell you how bad I think Nicho Hynes' ankle is, but I actually don't know officially. So I just don't want to be that person that goes off. I could have tweeted from the ground. I mean, the first one to do it, but it's not my place to do it. Someone else did that. I'll let them look like the hero / jackass for doing that. I don't want to be that guy. That's my agenda here. I love the club. I want the best for it. They are not above criticism, whether it's the board, the CEO, the chairman, the captain, the halfback, whoever it is. They're open to criticism on our show, but we are also very supportive of the people who play for our team. Hopefully I've explained that well. I feel like I haven't, but hopefully I have. Appreciate you being in touch. Ashley says, can you address the rumor mill about Hynes potentially interested in a move to the Cowboys? And that's in relation to a really bad rumor that went around on social media last week. And we addressed that in a few episodes. And Ash, it's just complete rubbish. You shouldn't even give it the time of day. I know that not everyone has access to contacts and media and the club like other people do. But as people who, if you're going to be on social media, you need to be aware of all these things that are happening in the world and how many fools are on there and how many people are going to try and fool you just to be a hero. And no, Nicho Hynes is completely staying at Cronulla. It's where he belongs. It's where he loves to be. And hopefully when he returns from his ankle injury, he'll be in the best form he can be in. Thanks for being in touch, Ash. Appreciate you. Ian was back in touch. He said winning 54% of games last year, like the Raiders, was enough to get you into the finals. So better off than nine teams, even though you lose every second week. Yet we moan every time we lose. Human nature, I guess. Yeah, we do moan every time we lose. But to be fair, we've been losing a lot more lately than we have been. So I can see both sides of that. Michael has been in touch. RCB, he said, Olympics. Clinton's joke last week made me laugh. Don't know if he has the shoulders for the shot put. Luke Cavell's kid will go well. Hope she gets the gold. Can't wait for flag football, the next one. Some farmer getting burned by Justin Jefferson is going to feed families. Oh, man. The talk of Justin Jefferson's got me nice and excited. Now, I think that might be all the emails for now. Neil said, enjoyed your catch-up with Kieran. Are you enjoying the Wyatt Six? Now, that's a wrestling question. So, if you're not into wrestling, tune out for like 20 seconds. I'm loving the Wyatt Six. I think it's genius, and I hope that they continue to honor Bray the way they are, and I can't wait each week to see what kind of horrific action's going to happen. All right, next up we have Brown Snake 750. They say, addressing the lack of energy at Shark Park on the Hill, we're a very quiet crowd. I can't remember the last time I heard a proper Sharkies chant. Do you think it's due to the numbers? Ever since the Hooligans Hill on the northeast side of the ground got shut down, it's been dire. Not sure if it's just spoiled younger fans who've only seen relative success. Home ground advantage doesn't exist if it feels like you're playing to an empty stadium. I feel like we need all the noisy fans to get organized and hang out in a specific area, make noise, and actually get around the team. The CSSC seems to have died off, but getting involved in that could help lift the ground and creating a bit of atmosphere. I know that at as recent as the last, I think it was the annual meeting or the members meeting, something like that, there was talk about looking into ways to create a better atmosphere for everyone, both the players and the crowd. So I know that they're aware of it. And I mean, the people down the end of where the Monty Porter stand is, they're pretty into it. They're pretty vocal. They're pretty lick it up. So I feel like they can make some noise when they want to, when it's applicable. But yeah, I'm with you. I like the idea. I definitely like the idea. Thank you. Brad says, I'm not sure about the bench rotation. It seems most people are seeing players gassed long before Fitzgibbon does. Tonight he put on Big Tuku for roughly 10 minutes. I don't understand hooking him when he's bending the line. Also, I'm not sure if there's anything in this, but the whole Sharks team were out in the field warming up for 10 minutes before even the Titans' backs came out. Not sure if there's anything in that. Yeah, Brad, I mean, the bench rotation is very much a personal thing with these coaches. They all do it differently. I personally have seen Tuku play big minutes in Cup, and obviously NRL is a higher level, higher energy, but I would have thought he could go longer than the 10 minutes he does. What I will say is there are heart monitors and all sorts of GPSs happening, and there are people in the box telling the coach what's going on as far as their fitness goes, and there's obviously a thought behind it. So I don't think they're just sort of willy-nilly taking guys on and off. There's reasons for it. As far as the warm-up stuff goes, I mean, we can look into that as much as we want. At the end of the day, you and I are not experts on this. I've had similar feelings at different times in watching the team over the last, you know, 35 years or whatever, and we don't know the answers. I know it feels like we do, but we just don't, and they're the experts. They know what they're doing. So I'm with you. You're saying that because we're out there longer, the starts are slower. I get it. But I don't think there's anything behind that personally. But I completely appreciate you being in touch. Different Brad has been in touch. Don't know where to start, but a completely inept performance again. What's going on? There's clear vision of Tricky blowing up at his halves partner, which I think is what Jacqueline was referring to before as well. How do you manage Nicho? In my opinion, he needs a rest. How do you rest him? Every breath he takes is scrutinized. Imagine the storm if Fitz sat him out for a few weeks. His confidence has been eroded and his leadership is non-existent. He looks lost and scared. So just on that, obviously he's getting a rest. We've covered that. And due to his ankle injury. I don't think his leadership's non-existent. And the lost and scared thing, I know where you're coming from. Like, I saw the look on his face when he missed that field goal against Canterbury. But I just think that he's a professional athlete. He has been elite in his short career in first grade. And he's going to get that back. I think we're part of the problem, Brad, you and I, scrutinizing the scrutinization of him, you know. He's going to have some time off. That's unavoidable now. So some of this stuff is a little bit, I guess, untimely, what you've written. And I appreciate you writing in. And I want to acknowledge it, of course. But I guess in a lot of ways it's a relief because, I mean, I want him out there. I wouldn't have rested him. I'd have let him get through it. But at least there's time now to kind of let him be. If that's what everyone's convinced he needed, then he's got it. Painful way to get it. You say Blake Island needs to have its zoning laws changed and some redevelopment needs to happen quickly. His defense was awful. We don't have an alternative. We signed the Queensland Cup Player of the Year and never gave him a chance. I could go on, but I fear the avalanche of mail you're going to receive will consume your every spare moment. Brad, you're spot on. You're spot on. It's consuming my every moment. That's okay, because that's what I've asked for. Right in. Blake Island. Looked not good last week. Defensively, a little bit off. Two tries through him. I'll say this. I wouldn't be surprised if the Queensland Cup Player of the Year you're talking about had a run of some sort in the near future. So watch this space. That's just my opinion. It's nothing else but my opinion. I personally, from what I've seen, don't think he's the answer, and I say that respectfully. But you know what? As you say, he hasn't been given a chance. Sean says it's our home game. Why can't we wear our home strip? I think they just chose the black one. I don't have an answer as to why, but the powers that be at Cronulla, from way up to down a little bit, they choose that kind of thing. Our friend Lush says, I'm exasperated. I can't even with this team right now. It's bad to worse. It's the absolute worst. I don't think I've ever seen such a gutless performance from this team. Please make it all make sense. Lush, I think you're a little bit over the top there, and I'm saying that respectfully, and it's just my opinion. You may tell me that I'm wrong, but I've seen more gutless performances, especially from the Sharks over the years, and this ain't it. But it's not good. It's not good. And I hope you're doing well. Hope the podcast is going well. Now we're going to move over to a different platform as we talk. Hope you're having as much fun as I am. Okay, Brad has been in touch and he asked about audio on the podcast. So if anyone's having issues with audio and the podcast, I need you to write me, DM me, because Brad has had some issues. I'm not experiencing that when I listen back to the podcast, and I'm not doing anything different, but something is going on. So if you have issues with the audio volume, let me know, please. Brad also says, why don't we ever try to build any pressure? We conceded 7 line dropouts tonight. The Titans kept pressure on us all night. I don't know why we don't ever really attempt it. Surely we'd be near the bottom for dropouts. Look, we're not last, but I think we're closer to the bottom than the top. I think Jacqueline also raised that as well, and please refer back to that one, but I think it is the idea that they want to keep the ball in play. That's the short answer, Brad. Appreciate you. Our friend Ash at All Things Cronulla Sharks on the Instagram and the Sharks Historian said, I listened to your post-match review with Solo Dan. It makes me wonder if I know as much about football as I sometimes think I do, because I think Will Kennedy is our best and most consistent performer. I'm amazed that some people think he needs to go. Am I wrong? You're not wrong. No one's wrong for having their opinion. I'm on your side. I think he's been really great this year. There's things he needs to improve. I think his attack has lessened in sharpness and in productivity in the last, 6 weeks. He's safe as houses under the bomb. Defensively, I think there has been improvement. There needs to be a little bit more week to week, but I think there has been improvement. And I'm quite happy with him. I think it's a money ball thing where we're not paying him millions of dollars and he performs at a pretty high standard. And I think there's room there to grow. There is a young fella coming through we've spoken about as well who will be hot on his tails probably in the next year or two. So I'm with you though. I like Will. And it's all just up to interpretation, isn't it? Chad says, where do I start? I get we had no ball for most of the first half and our errors exceeded theirs. We had 10 minutes without a player in the first half. But as soon as I saw Nico react to the niggle, I knew we were in trouble. I know you know people on the inner sanctum. How does Fitz's pregame speech differ to that of the halftime one? We win second halves, but not first. Side note, Atkinson is not a winger, and yes, I know Stone Street and Hirodi wasn't available. So, yep, agree with you on all that. I think that the pregame speech, and I don't know this for a fact, but I'm assuming the pregame speech is very much focusing on what they have spoken about all week. It's confirming what's going to happen. And then if it doesn't go to plan, like it hasn't for a bunch of recent times, the speech becomes a little bit more urgent and a little bit more direct. So I don't know how much it differs, but I don't know if that's the problem. I can see why you think it's the problem, and I'm not saying it's not possible that it is the problem. Actually, I don't think it's the problem. Completely respect your opinion there, Chad. You also said, sorry, that was a long message. Chad, that was not even close to a long message, my friend. Thank you so much for being in touch. Reese says, haven't messaged for a while, but I feel like I need to tonight. Well, you're always welcome, Reese, and thanks for being in touch. I'm so shattered. We're much better than what we showed tonight against the Titans. I see the team looks shattered and Nico looks frustrated. The worst part is our team is much better than that. We've shown it before. It's very disheartening. One thing I've noticed is the small effort areas such as line speed and kick chase are non-existent. Every time Titans kick the ball, they had players breathing down Will Kennedy's neck. We never really returned the same treatment. Despite this, I'm staying positive. We can turn things around. Thank you. I love all the jerseys Kieran wears in the Monday Morning Coffee Show. And that includes the yellow one. You're all legends. Can't wait for the next pod. Reese, that is so lovely. Thank you so much for being in touch. Thank you for your kind words. I'll pass that on to Kieran as well, although I'm sure he's probably listening as well because he's a tragic, like all of us. On your points, look, I agree. We're better than this. And I think even without Nico for the next while, due to injury, we're better than this. We've got a good team. So it's up to them to kind of start well and show the world that we are better than this. And now we're going to cross over to one more platform as we talk, getting closer to the end of this podcast. I'll save the best for last. I don't know if that's true or not. Okay. In no particular order. Now, Gaz has been in touch. And Gaz recently returned from Fiji. And when he was there, he took a whole lot of Sharks hats and so forth to pass out to the locals. They love their footy, but they can't afford or get their hands on the gear themselves. I'm trying to collect old spare hats, which I could collect to take over on my next trip. I typically take hats more than clothes because it's one size fits all and it's much easier to transport. Hope it makes sense. It's not a mercy mission or anything, but it's a way of promoting the club to these specific folks who are less fortunate than ourselves. Gaz, that's an awesome thing to do. I will try and reply to you about that and getting in touch with some people. If I don't reply to you, please remind me because I've just got a million things going on and that's on me. It's a negative on me and just, yeah, remind me if I don't reply to you, but hopefully I will. Daniel has been in touch. He said, Hynes has gone injured. Time to panic? ? I don't think it's time to panic. I just think there's a realization that it's going to be a uphill battle to get to the ultimate place we want to be. The good news, Daniel, is we're still in the top four. Win this week, bye next week. That's 4 points to kick on and stay in the top four for a while. The run home is not too bad. There's a good team that will, at their best, provide lots of opportunities for Dan Atkinson and for Braden Trindle to get the team going. And I don't think it's season over. I just think it's going to be tough. But that doesn't mean it can't be done. Work hard for each other. Finish in the top four. You get two bites of the cherry. You never know what's going to happen. Oh, I think we stay tough. And it sounds like Nicho may be back for the finals in some capacity, whether he's around about there or whether it's week one, week two, week three. I'm not sure. But the latest things that we're hearing as time goes on in this podcast is that he may be back, which is surprising to me given what I saw at training today. But that's the latest reports. Thanks, Daniel. Steve's been in touch. The team just keeps losing. There was this listener on the last mail section saying Hynes is better at number one. He's not a half anymore. I believe if Fitzy doesn't put him at number one, then don't play him at all. You also believe Tuku has to be in the 17 and need more spark and attack. That's where Stone Street comes in. You also say, I'm reading that Hynes is not happy at the club, mainly due to disgruntled fans against him and the club facilities. Is this true? Mate, Stephen, I've already addressed this from Ashley, but it is completely not true. It is just some idiot online stirring up trouble. It is so easy for someone, anyone in this world, to write something about someone else on social media, whether it's your ex, whether it's your Facebook, whether it's your Instagram, TikTok, whatever it is you're on. If you just go on there and write something, A, no one moderates it, and B, it's hard to prove. And I think I've used this example before, but if I go on there and I say, I'm in line to support Bruce Springsteen on his next tour to Australia, who's going to dispute that? You know, or whatever. That's just as wholesome as it gets. But you could say anything about anyone, and people usually do. And no one cares. It's just like, oh, this must be the truth. And so in this example, some moron wrote something as a joke, ha-ha, like I'm close to someone who's close to Nicho Hynes and he wants out. And then the thing starts trending like it's something. It's nothing. If you're close to someone who's close to Nicho Hynes, if you had that information, you're not going to be putting it on social media for starters. Also, he's really happy. He's the king of Caringbah. He's happy in the Shire, happy at the club. They love him. He loves them. It's all going fine. They're just not winning games of late. That's it. That's the bottom line. It's so annoying to me, and I apologize to you, Steve. This isn't about you, but I just get so much communication about the stupidest things I've ever heard. And I have intel, so I am blessed to know that none of this is true. If I didn't have the intel, I would still know it's not true. Please, 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 people, just because you read something on the internet does not make it true. But Steve, you're not happy. You say you'd rather talk about WWE or music. How's all that going, Sam? Way more entertaining than this lot. I can see them dropping out of the eight into the bottom four by season's end. Show me a reason I'm wrong. I'll leave it up to reality. We will all see it. I love the Sharks, but I'm just another unhappy supporter. I'll have fun watching the Survivor Series coming up. Win if you can, Sharks. Well, first of all, Steven, Survivor Series is not for a while. I think you're thinking about SummerSlam. Anyway, I'm happy to talk about music and WWE all you like. Dude, hang on. There's wins coming around the corner. They're coming. It's circumstantial now because the halfback's out, but half of you wanted him out anyway. So I'm really getting confused. Steven, appreciate you writing in as always. Thank you. All right, Scott has been in touch, and he said that Scott's made it clear to me he's friends with the fellow who owns the bookshop in Cronulla, the little bookshop. And he says he meets all sorts of people in the Shire. And when discussing Nicho wanting to leave the team, with one reason being the substandard home ground compared to the Cowboys and plenty of others, I think They actually want to get rid of it so they can build more apartments. I've heard that from someone with close connections in the Shire. So Scott was in touch about rumours, which is timely given the last correspondence from Steve. And a bunch of that, Scott, I can't read out because it's almost defamatory, but I appreciate it. And you are referring to the home ground and the future of it. So I think that a lot of what you're talking about is just rumour-based. So I'll leave it at that for now. Thank you so much for being in touch. Okay, Brent has been in touch. He's a regular correspondent. You say, what's this team we're watching lately? Is it a comedy? They've become the joke of the NRL, beaten by the bottom three teams. You want a spoiler for next week? Tigers by 10. That's from Brent. We keep hearing about them working on the first half starts. It's not working. Telling fans they trained well, they worked on things, but it still happens. And bad starts are unforgivable every week. The whole team is unforgivable. Yeah, I mean, I'm with you in a sense, Brent, that we do keep hearing about it and it keeps happening. You also say you can see us dropping from the 8 in the next 4 weeks. You say you're done wasting your time this year on them watching loss after loss. I hope they remember how to play very soon and good luck for the remainder of the season. You're not going to watch until things look brighter. Just final results for me now to ease the pain of watching. For what it's worth, go the Sharks. So Brent, from that I'm taking that it's all a bit too much for you to watch. And you're going to just watch. You're just going to wait for the final results. And I have no problem with that because in all seriousness, if it upsets you that much, and we've had a few people this year tell us how much it upsets them. If it upsets you that much, my man, you're doing the right thing. Don't watch. The only thing I'll say, and I say it to everyone, is that you got to be there in the bad times to enjoy the good times. I know you've been there watching them for ages. I get it. But I just think that, man, you got to stick strong. Come on, stick strong. Stick with the team. Doesn't mean you have to excuse everything they do. You can criticize them all you want. But stick with them. You can't just sort of come back in for the good times, can you? Maybe you can. Thanks, man. Hope you're doing well. Sam has been in touch. Any chance Sharkcast can get King of Carrying Bar t-shirts made? I'd buy one for sure. Hope you're well up up. That's from Sam. And that's not from me, a different Sam. You know, I'd never thought about it. But we might talk to our friends at rugbymerch.com and see what we can do, the legalities, etc. But it'd be great to support the King of Carrying Bars for sure. Appreciate you, my man. Thank you so much. I think, potentially, that's the correspondence this week. If I've missed anyone, if I've missed anything, I completely apologize. We will get to it. You can always remind me if I've somehow missed it. But I think that's pretty accurate, everything that's been written to us since the Titans game. Thank you so much. I know this episode has just been me and your words, and that can be punishing. I apologize. It's a one-off week where it's just hard to schedule given a whole lot of things happening in life and short turnarounds, etc., etc. So hopefully you've had a laugh. Hopefully you've had something out of this show. You've learned something. I don't know. Something to get you through, because that's the aim of the whole thing, isn't it? Stay tuned to your news channels and everything else about Nicho Hynes. The latest we're hearing is 8 to 9 weeks. Again, I say that surprises me, but I'm happily surprised if that's the case. And wish him all the best. Friday night, Shark Park, if you can get down there, get down there. Create some atmosphere, some noise, however it is you like to experience your game day. But get down there and support the team if you can, if you're up to it, if you're able to. And hopefully they can win, go into the bye, reset again. We said it last time, but reset again and get on with the season in a winning way. It's going to be tough without Nicho for a while, but nothing is impossible. We've seen what these guys can do when under pressure. Trindle has been successful against the best teams on his own. So has Dan Atkinson. Put them together. Hopefully they can gel. Appreciate every single one of you. Spread the word around. Sharkcast Pod. As a disclaimer, you may not hear from us again until around game day or post-game day. Or this will be the flagship show, I think, guys and girls. So unless something else happens later in the week, appreciate everything you guys do for us. Appreciate everyone listening to us and viewing us on the YouTube, Subscribe is the best thing you can do on your podcast apps, on YouTube, on the social media. Subscribe to us, and the best thing you can do as well is just to spread the word to your friends, family, people at the ground especially. The podcast does really well, but there's a bigger audience to crack, and we want to get there one day. And every time one of you mentions us to someone else, it's a positive thing. And if they don't like it, that's totally fine as well. Not for everyone, that's for sure, the old Sharkcast. Appreciate you guys. I'm tired of hearing my own voice. I hope you're not. Up, up, let's go win on Friday. Sharkies! Sharkies!
Shire, turn your porch lights off because we're coming home with a trophy.